Very good morning and greetings. I am Radha Krishna Prasad. Let me give you a short brief about myself. I have a total of close to 10 years of experience into core performance testing and engineering on different versions of Mercury Interactive, HP and Micro Focus LoadRunner, Apache JMeter, NeoLoad and all other tools. I have been involved in each and every individual phase of performance testing lifecycle and engineering lifecycle, right from the non-functional requirement gathering till the sign-off. And I have been a part of Performance Center of Excellence, where we define roadmaps to most of the customers. We educate the customers who really don't know from where they have to start the performance testing, and the strategies and all of the stuff. And apart from that, from the learning and development part, I have also trained 4,000 plus associates and TCS client level. Currently, I am working on CA APM performance testing, which is a competitor for Dynatrace, New Relic and AppDynamics. I am working as a senior performance SME there, where I'll be doing all this agents performance testing for all the emerging tech stack, where we create, develop so many agents like to Kafka, Spark, artificial intelligence, machine learning, what are all the target servers we have, different web app DB servers, including load balancers, FI and Nginx. We configure the agents. We do the performance testing, capacity testing of all the agents, how each agent will actually handle some millions of metrics in 1 hour or in a day or in a month. Okay, that is all about myself. So the intention of taking this article is basically the garbage collection in Java is very, very huge. Okay, it will take some months and years to learn. I mean, based on the practice that you have from the and engineering, it will take a lot many days to learn all of them. But here the main focus to deal with this session is, what are all the typical GC performance problems that you see as part of performance testing, right? How do you monitor GC? So how do you profile a program from the code profiling playset from the unit level, or from it from performance testing side, how do you configure your profiling tools to your IDE or the application where that is deployed on your multiple application servers? How do you configure some multiple profiling tools like JProfiler or Java Mission Control or JVisual VM? And the first main point is, how do you choose basically the best garbage collector for your use case? For especially if you take the baselining and benchmarking for the very first time, if you're starting a project, if you're testing the performance of that project, so you must be doing some baselining and benchmarking for that project. You must be aware of something called early performance testing, right? Testing all some microservices, some code snippets, some every piece of functionality that a developer is developing. If you want to test all of them, you are actually identifying the type of the application, and you're also identifying the allocation rate that it has, the size of the objects, okay, and how the objects are being allocated, and how each and unique garbage collector that you're selecting in your Java JVM is working on your use cases. Okay, before going to that question, we'll talk about some of the basic concepts. Let me share my screen. Okay, are you able to see my screen? All of you?
Yeah, yes, we can see.
Yes, yes.
So this is one article which is specific to how we have to select the best garbage collection algorithm for your performance testing use case. Not only performance testing use case, as part of early performance testing, even from the development side, before they do some code reviews, code profiling, or code refactoring, every time they give some multiple options for their research to understand what is really happening with the different garbage collection algorithms that they are selecting. Okay, before I talk about that, So let's make this session interactive, because if you keep asking some questions, other people will also understand what some of the basic concepts are. So if you take the first question, does every performance engineer need to know about how Java memory works? My answer is yes. The reason is because with the emerging technology stack, okay, as the traditional performance testing days have gone, we are actually stepping into something called CI/CD testing, shift left performance testing, and every performance testing project that we currently have in every organization is trying to adopt the core performance engineering process, okay, which will actually involve many of the activities like application performance, system level performance, user level performance, network level performance, for all of this to monitor, to identify all the different bottlenecks across the different layers that we have from the client side and server side. Okay, depending upon the tech stack you have. For example, if you have a Kubernetes containerized environment, which is completely Dockerized with a microservices architecture, you need to have a right APM solution in place, like Dynatrace or AppDynamics or any other APM tool which has some extra capabilities to monitor all of them right from the beginning, which should have a continuous monitoring kind of activity. If you take Java, I'll tell you why Java is important. If you take the industry, if you take the applications, even I'm seeing many of the customers continuing still with the same legacy code. Even if you take some of the applications that are developed in the early 90s or in 2002 or 2004, all these are applications are developed some 15, 20 years back on the initial versions of Java, some Java framework. And most of the customers, even today, okay, I'm working with a customer, I don't want to disclose the name, but that customer's expectation was to improve the performance in all the ways without touching the code, okay, which is a highly impossible task. So if you take the recent releases of all the JDKs, right, there are a lot of performance improvements that happened, okay. There are so many other collectors that has operated. They have been released from the JDK 13, 14, and 11, but they are not completely implemented yet. The reason is because they are still under some R&D, and they are called as experimental collectors. So they're doing some lot many changes. They're updating the features of all those collectors from release to release. But before that, we have some four stable, collectors like serial GC, parallel GC, which is also called the parallel old GC. Okay, you have garbage G1C, garbage first collector, and you also have CMS, which is a very famous one, concurrent mark and sweep. Okay, so before talking with all of that thing, all of that stuff, so I would strongly recommend all the performance engineers who have 1 year experience or who just started their career into performance testing and engineering, if you want to completely transform your career from performance testing to engineering, you should learn Java. A basic hands-on core Java experience is required to become a successful performance engineer, which will involve all the activities of monitoring, fine-tuning, code profiling, understanding all the different bottlenecks from the code level, system level, user level, to some percentage. If you take 60 to 70% of the activity will be done if you are selecting a right APM tool. You can select all the metrics. You can the main advantage of the APM, if you take, you can configure something called alerts, anomalies, and alarms. I'm not sure how many of you know this thing, but if you take Dynatrace or CAPM or AppDynamics, the advanced versions of APM is very, very huge. It will take years to learn APM, but one main thing in APM is, if you're monitoring many of the metrics from all the different tiers that you have in your infrastructure, in your application, or in your architecture, So what you can do is you can create a simple alert. Alert is nothing but it says that you will be running out of memory in the next 2 hours, where the immediate intervention is not really required. That is called alert. Okay, so alarm is something that you have a high latency issue, but you may not take an action immediately again, but in the next 30 minutes you can take an action and you can simply give some availability of the network latency. You can optimize it, or you can ask the respective team to step in and see what is happening. The last one is called after anomaly. The last one is alarm. If you are setting an alarm on any of the metric from APM, it directly says that your application is down, okay, and the availability is zero, where your intervention is immediately required. So when with all this stuff, you already have some 50% or the 60% of engineering activities in place. But if you really want to identify what really happened from the performance application side, for example, many of the people must be seeing high CPU utilization, and you must be facing a common interview question in any of the performance testing evaluations. What are the reasons for high CPU spinning? Okay. What is the reason for high memory utilization? What does stop the world event mean? Okay. What is minor GC, major GC, full GC? What is the difference between permgen and metaspace? So the first thing, the reason why I have explained all of this stuff before I start garbage collection is because you need to have every performance engineer, everyone, right from the day one, he or she has to understand how the memory management in Java will work. The first point. The second point is, you have to understand the basic structure of a program. What is a class? How do you create a method? How do you create an object? There are few things like what is an array? What is a constant variable? What is a local variable? What is something like string concatenation? There are few other basic things you need to get some good hands-on experience, at least writing some 20 basic hacker rank, so that you will really understand how the program is working. Okay. The third point is you need to understand what is a JVM. Okay. There is a very big JVM architecture diagram. Okay. So this is a JVM diagram. Can all of you please place your call on mute, please? Okay. Okay. Thank you. Thanks for that. So if you look at the JVM diagram, there are three main components, the class loader subsystem and the runtime data area and the execution engine. So before you start with GC, I would suggest all of you to go through and understand what is this JVM. So JVM, if you take the runtime data areas as part of our performance testing and engineering, we are mainly worried about the one of the area that we have here, which is called heap area. And there is another area called stack area. There are two different types of memories in heap. One is heap and one is stack. Okay. Every time you see a lot of issues in your application, right? Many issues that you see. For example, if you take your application is not responding all of a sudden. Okay, you got some out of memory error exception, or you see a memory leak. Okay, your application ran out of memory, or there is some Java heap depletion. It can be from operating system level, or it can be from the JVM side, from the native memory. And again, the JVM has its own memory settings. And there are so many symptoms, like you will have a sudden failure on the application. You will have too much of slowness on your Java application. The main problematic, the famous error that you always see is java.lang.outofmemory error.javaheapspace. This is the exception every time you see it. Okay. So, and when you see all these kind of issues, you have a high CPU utilization on the server. Okay, when you have a high CPU utilization on the server, the side effect of this high CPU utilization is, again, you will see excess memory usage, high memory utilization. The reason is because these all things are happening due to increased GC activity. We'll go to that. So you need to understand how the JVM will work, and there are different JVMs. One of the famous JVM is Oracle Hotspot JVM that we currently have in our JDK. Okay, so likewise you have many other JVMs. For example, if you take some of the applications like in for .NET applications, like JVM in Java, what is that we have? Anyone?
CLR.
It is CLR, Common Language Runtime. Yeah. So this the same way, if the application is developed on any of the scripting languages, Perl or any other languages, you have a Parrot based VM, okay, that is called PVM. So that is very rarely used. Like that, you have many other JVMs in the market, hundreds of JVMs, but one of the most famous JVM is the Oracle Hotspot JVM, okay, for all the Java applications, and the CLR for all the .NET applications. So before I start, I told you, right? So you need to learn JVM. You have to completely understand the architecture of what exactly is JVM, and especially in the runtime areas, you have to understand what is the role of heap memory here. And you will be having so many questions, I know that. What is the initial, how do I set the initial and maximum heap? So can I set the initial and maximum heap as same? What should be the size of my permgen? Okay, what is metaspace from Java JDK 8? So these are all the different questions from the performance engineering side. And remember, so the traditional performance testing days have gone. No one is asking you what is the difference between when I started my career in 2010, I used to face some question, what is correlation? What is the difference between parameterization and correlation? Checkpoints. What is the difference between Webrixio param and Webrixio param EX, regex? All these things are not at all asked. So if I want to hire a skilled performance engineer, I am trying to understand what are all his different approaches to fine tune his application. If at all, if I want to show the improvement, the percentage of improvement in terms of performance of my application, to what percentage improved from last release to this release, conducting the same test with 2000 users, running it for 5 hours with the same settings, with the same metrics configured using the same APM tool. I need to highlight the differences that I have been observed in both the tests. So to give you the, to project this number, the percentage of the improvement, you need to have the skills, especially the core Java skills. The detailed understanding of Java JVM is required. What is the role of heap is required. So these things are required. So before, this is all about the basics, the performance basics. So before I start with garbage collection, what is garbage collection and how does it work? As I told you, you can go here and you can refer this article. So there are multiple diagrams that are available in different blogs, different Java sites, but all you need to understand is what are all the JVM arguments that you have to set. Okay, what is the criteria that you need to set for your application depending upon your own requirements? Okay, you can be using one single JVM or multiple JVMs running on your application. Your application can be a one-tier architecture or an entire architecture, but the point here is you have to see what are all the different parameters that you need to set for all the heap. There is no standard generalized formula for setting up the heap. Tell you one single best practice. So the best practice for defining a heap is you are not supposed to define the heap greater than your physical memory on your JVM, okay, on your Java machine. So the second point is the minimum heap size can be 64th size of your physical memory, 1/64th component, the size of physical memory can be your initial heap. The maximum heap memory can be the 1/4th size of your physical memory of your machine. All right. So if you see here, I'm sorry. If you see here, I have given so many diagrams for your reference. Okay. So just at a very high level, let me explain you here. So you have three different generations. One is heap. Basically, the memory is divided into heap and non-heap memory. Okay. So in the heap memory, you have two different regions. One is younger generation and one is older generation. Okay. So in younger generation, you have again two different spaces. One is hidden space and one is survivor space. And this survivor space has two survivor spaces. Okay. And you may also, you can also be asked in the interviews, why do I have multiple survivor spaces in survivor space, survivor 0 and survivor 1? Okay. And you have older generation and you have, then you have permanent generation. Permgen, if you see the permgen here, this is till JDK 8. Okay. Now the permgen from till JDK 7, you have this permgen. From JDK 8, this permgen is replaced with something called metaspace. Okay. So all the different issues that you see, okay, I have clearly written here, as we are not covering this heap in this. So I'm giving you the reference of this article. Again, the heap is another very big concept. So better, my suggestion to all of you is go through this document. I have clearly stated all the different errors that you see in your performance testing assignments. Like if it is a stack overflow error, out of memory error, or if it is the metaspace error, whichever the error that you get with respect to the memory, it will give you this message in the end. Okay, GC overhead limit exceeded. It's saying that it is an issue with the GC. So if you get an issue like this, java.lang.out of memory exception, permgen space, the issue is with permgen. So if you if you get an issue with the metaspace, then you have to increase the metaspace. So now tell me one thing, whenever you get the out of memory exceptions or out the errors, okay, so what is the first thing that you do as part of a performance engineering fix? You have observed that you have seen high response times, you have high CPU spinning, you have high memory utilization, or you have some memory leak, and you noticed that there is some out of memory. The first step that you do?
Checking heap dump.
Check heap memory, CPU.
That is all okay, but what is that you do to fix it?
We'll check which process is taking more memory.
Okay.
We'll check whether which class is causing the problem basically. So by using tool or by using the memory, the heap dump, we'll extract that which class and which method is taking the is the cause for this memory leak, which is taking the high memory basically.
Mm-hmm. So whenever you get out of memory exception, many of the performance engineers, what they do is they go back to the test and they increase the heap memory. Okay. Now my question is, increasing the heap memory, is that fixing your issue? Is that improving the performance of your application?
No, not always.
This can be the major problem, because if you increase the heap size, then your GC will take longer time to clear maybe like the long existing objects. So running GC is like halting the whole world.
Right. Actually, what will happen is, if increasing the heap size will not improve the performance of your application by 0.001%. Not improve the performance at all. But increasing the heap size, what it will do is, it will increase your response times. If you're actually seeing. Hang on. Can all of you mute your lines, please? Sorry for that. Thank you so much. So, increasing the heap size, what it will do is, if you're running a load test for 3 years, if you are seeing this out of memory exception or memory leak in the after 1.5 hour of completion of your test, if you increase your heap size, it will postpone the error. That's all. It will not improve the performance of your application. Instead of seeing the same error after 1.5 hour of completion of our test, you will be seeing that test. You will be seeing the same error after 2.5 hours or 2 hours 15 minutes. It is not improving the performance of your test. Remember, it will increase, as someone said just now, it will increase when the heap size is growing big, it will increase the GC activities. And when you have this minor GC or major GC or full GC that are happening on all the regions of the heap, so if the major GC is taking a lot of time on your heap memory to clear all the unused, unreferenced objects to reclaim the memory, what it will do? When the major GC is happening or any GC is happening, it will
stop all the threads.
Suspend all the threads that are executing. It will terminate all the threads for the time GC is running. Okay. And that will create a very huge impact on your application performance. For example, response time of a particular transaction, you say make payment or add to cart, is you are already seeing a response time of 11 to 15 seconds. And whenever the major GC is happening, so the major GC happened for 6.8 seconds or 7 seconds, for let's say 7 seconds, and your response time is 8 seconds. When the GC is taking 7 seconds to perform this GC on the older generation, it will suspend all the threads, it will terminate all the executing threads, and this is called stop the old events. Okay, when this situation like this happen, whatever the time that has been taken for the major GC to perform, this time will get added to the response time of that transaction, of that functionality or of that activity. I told you, right? The response time of that transaction is some 9.2 seconds, and you have some 7 seconds GC pause time, something like that. And this GC pause time will get added to your response time, and your response time of your transaction will be 15 plus seconds, which is not at all acceptable. So every time you want to fix something from the Java application, GC will play a very, very important role. Okay. To optimize the performance, you have to optimize the GC pause times, you have to optimize the activity of minor GC, major GC and full GC, and that is where you need to concentrate, and you have multiple tools for that. Okay, and before I before we start the advanced garbage collection concepts, so
sorry to interrupt, I have one question on this.
Yes.
You said, right, increasing the heap memory is not always the solution, but let's say our memories, our heap memories also should to be very realistic, right? If we define it very less in size, so always the object from the minor memory always will promote it to the older GC, tenured memory, right? And in that case, there will be, instead of many minor GC, there will be frequent major GC that will happen. Right.
No, so, that depends upon the object age, right? See, two things here: the object allocation rate, how the object is being used. Is it being very used frequently, or is that the object is being referred by many other objects? There is a GC root concept. I'll tell you what it is. Going forward, once after completing that topic, I'll clarify your question in the end of the session. Okay. So, basically, it depends upon the object age. It depends upon the nature of the object, how it is being referred, with how many number of objects it is referred. And if it is, for example, if it is again a permanent information, like the lifelong classes, there are something called lifelong classes, which are completely, oh my God, hang on, one moment, please. Yeah, if you have something, there are some permanent classes which are continuously accessed all the time, 365 days, 24/7. They're not deleted. They directly, all the meta information of all the classes and objects of all the stack, everything is being stored in something called meta space. But whatever is, whatever has to be deleted, whatever has to be promoted, it depends on how you define the heap memory. It depends on the nature of the objects, the age of the objects, and how it is being holded with other references. So we'll talk about that. So again, this basically Java application, any Java application will, I mean, we are talking about this heap, right? Okay. So you have like this, in the young generation, you have Eden and Survivor space. And again, Survivor contains two multiple spaces. Some of them call it as S0 and S1, and some of them call S1 and S2. And you have an older memory, and you have, if you look at the memory structure here, okay, the size of the older generation is very big. Okay, from this diagram itself, you can understand that. The size of, I'm not talking about how we have to define all of them here, because it takes a lot of time. So what, if you see the diagram here, the size of the older memory is big, okay? The next size is given to younger generation. If you see the perm gen, it is very less if you compare to the Eden and old, sorry, young generation and old. And if you come to this minor GC will happen on the young generation, and the major GC will happen on the old generation, and the full GC will on the young, old and perm gen. Okay. So which will completely trigger all the unused objects. This is at a very high level. We'll talk about the heap dump analysis in another session sometime later, but this is at a very high level. So coming back to this collection, if I talk about tuning of any Java application, right? Okay, so you are basically trying to understand for a given request, how quickly the application is responding. Okay, how quick a UI responds to an event, for example, or how fast is a website returning a web page, or how fast a database query is fetching some data. Oh my God, what happened to this guy? Okay, so you are basically checking the responsiveness. The main agenda is to check the that every time we focus on the responsiveness, and for this to achieve the better responsiveness of our application in terms of response times and all other stuff, we are mainly focusing on the large pause times, the world, the stop the world events, which are not acceptable. We are continuously monitoring all of them. I'll show you how to monitor all of them using different tools. Okay, and the second point is the throughput. Okay, throughput, again, it focuses on maximizing the amount of work by the application, okay, in the specific period of time. For example, if you're running 1 hour or 2 hour or 8 hours test, okay, so what is actually measured in throughput is the main point here. The number of transactions completed in a given time, which is called TPS in load testing perspective, the number of jobs that are completed in a batch program, in an hour or in 4 hours or something, or the number of database queries that are completed in an hour. Okay, and the last point is latency. Okay, without having the complete information from the design phase before you start any of your performance testing project, okay, where the project, where the application, where the load testing is happening, Okay, is it happening on a prod-like environment, or is it happening the 50% of the prod-like environment, or is it a shared environment for development people, the functional testing people, and the performance testing people? When you use this environment, you send an email not to do any of the activities when you run the road test. But again, as I told you, the emerging performance engineering practice from 2020. What every customer is now asking the performance engineer to do is, you can run it on production. They don't have any issues. Because if you're running a test on a 50% of the environment or 25% of the prod size environment or any other environment, which is not a replica or mirror image of production environment, you get some issues, right? And you address them. You tell them that you have fine-tuned some of the issues, but nothing will help. The reason is because whatever the issues that you see in the test environment, you'll not be seeing the same issues on production environment. Because in the production environment, there will be a lot of backup running, there will be a lot of batch jobs running, there will be too many other activities that will be running on all the database servers, which will not happen on any of the QA environments. So whatever the issues that you see, you are just creating some confidence to the customer, saying that if I test with some n number of users, you may see these issues, and you may see this kind of behavior of your application. This is what you are saying. You are not guaranteeing that the application will perform as expected, and with 5,000 users in production, when you have too much of concurrency in the peak time, you will get 2 to 5 seconds of standard response time. That is not, you cannot guarantee that. That will become a false promise and a blind commitment to the customer, which will put the entire team into red, complete escalation. Okay, so the recent trend, if you take, you even we are already testing. Yes, you can do that. So for many of the applications, until and unless your customer doesn't have any issues, okay, with the data, especially with the data, okay, so you cannot go ahead and perform the test. The customer has to give the complete approval, and you have to perform this load testing on the prod environments only on the weekends, that too on Sundays, and there is a time slot. You cannot test, engineering test 8 hours, 12 hours, you can't do that. You can test for 30 minutes or 1 hour or a max of 2 hours, okay? And all the servers in the production will be monitored, okay? Existing application also, you can do it. That's not a problem.
Yeah, okay. But my concern is the data,
okay, so it is going into a different direction, but I'll clarify your question. So okay. For example, many of you must be having an issue with, okay, I have seen many people, I evaluate so many people, approximately I have asked the same question to some 100 plus people who came for the interviews. How do you create the test data for your load testing? For example, I need to run a test. We have recently done a test for 5 days with database replication testing. Our client wants us to do a performance testing for 5 days. Okay. Because the reason is he stops using all the different databases that he is having for all the 27 applications. He has Postgres, MongoDB, CassandraDB, Oracle, SQL Server, so many other databases. Now he came to a decision that all the applications has to sit on single Oracle DB. Okay, so we are completely testing it, and there are few scenarios where the data is unique. Okay, for example, if you are working in a BFSI application or any other Interpol application, the data of the candidate is unique. The SSN number is unique. The PAN card number in India is unique. The credit card number is unique. So we have tested one scenario where we need some 5 lakh plus records. Got it? 5 lakh records. I have to use that in my test. Okay. How do you generate this data? And remember, this data is unique. If you're using if one user is making use of one record in the test, you cannot use it for the second time. If any of the user is trying to use the same record, you will see a failed transaction. will see error in the application. Can any one of you now tell me how can you generate the test data if I need 5 lakh records?
We can ask the developers to give API of to generate data. Like they must have API to add user or to generate access code. Or
but that will help to some extent. It takes time. It will take some 1 month to create the data with a single API.
Actually, in my application, when I was doing testing earlier, I used to create test data by using manual by recording the scenario of adding the user and then by running that test, running the JMeter script, and that takes time. But using API will deal with the database directly, and that will take very less time.
Sorry to interrupt. What I did is, in my QA environment, what I did, I used the Python script to generate the records. And in the production, what happened, they did not allow my records to use there. So then at that time, what I did, I asked them to take the data, whatever you have in database, and de-identify it. But the structure should remain the same. For example, credit card 16 digit, de-identify it and ensure that there should not be a duplicate data. So that worked me.
Okay, so.
So other solution is we copy the production data and apply the masking solution. So with that, actually you'll have the enough test data. That's how actually we practice.
Okay, so I'll tell you what. So API or when you need some lakhs of data, APIs will not help. Okay. When you have some, there is some format of data. If you take the, you need to test every time, you have to test the application with the realistic data. You cannot test the application with whatever the data that is easy to create. We can't do that. So the exact replication has to happen on any of the tests because everything is happening virtually, which is not really existing. This is just a simulation. So what we do is we take the help of some of the test data generation tools, which are commercial. Okay. You need to identify format of the data. First point, for example, if you take the PAN card, APYPG, okay, the first 5 letters of the PAN card are alphabetic, then 6786, the next 4 digits are numeric, and the last digit A is again alphabetic. You need to format the data. You can create a regular expression in the some of the tools. It will generate a data. Okay, once you get this data, you need to take the help of the DBA. You need to identify the data access path of your database server. You need to understand to which table your application is hitting to, is accessing, is storing all the data, to which or to whatever the tables. You need to request the DBA to upload all the data. Now, once he gives a confirmation saying that the data has been successfully uploaded into the database. So the immediate step from the performance testing team should be to identify whether the data is really uploaded, whether I'm able to, tools like Prerequisite Pro from IBM. There are many other tools. We have client finder is an in-house tool of TCS when I worked. Okay, so there are multiple tools. Okay, it depends.
And the data second generator point, also is there, data generator, one of the tool.
You cannot expect to generate all the lakhs of data with the help of open source. You want to get the exact replication, right? Exact format of data. For example, some kind of numbers are there in some of the banking applications. Some are mixing of alphanumeric. They shuffle. The number keeps always shuffling, and they have 7 unique formats. To simulate all of them, and if the format is criteria is not working, you have a exception set on the front end directly in the client side. If you enter that number in the text, it will throw you an exception. This one is not valid. So for that reason, we are buying a commercial tool. And there are many other reasons, for secured reasons to secure the data, for better masking of the data, to keep the same format of the data. We are taking the best tools actually. Okay, that is one part. So the next immediate point is you have to take some records. Once the data is successfully uploaded, you have to take some 5 to 10 records and you have to search it from the front end by accessing the application in the browser. If you are able to search that record, it means that the data is successfully uploaded. Then you can go ahead and do the test. This is about test data. So let us come back. Talk about Java, the garbage collection. So talk about garbage collection.
Sorry to interrupt. So what is the tool that you mentioned?
Client Finder. I'll send you after this email, I'll share it with Gagan. So he'll be sharing all the information. I'll share you some information on garbage collection and all other stuff. So I'll share it with Gagan. He will be uploading it to Perf Matrix. Okay. Or you can also find it on my LinkedIn. I'll upload the comments. And remember, you need not learn the end-to-end concept of garbage collection. Garbage collection is so big. It is very huge. And if you take any JVM, right, from Java, JDK 11, JDK 13, the recent releases, if you take, you have 600 plus JVM arguments that are in use now. The experimental connectors that which we recently have from JDK 13 and 14 and 11. Okay, so you have 1000 plus JVM arguments, but here you need to understand what are the JVM arguments that we really need. So if you take the XX max, a new size, XMS, XMX values, perm size, these are all the metrics that we basically need. Okay. So I'll tell you what are all that you need. Okay. So one minute, please, because we are running out of time. We'll have all the, you can park your question aside for now. Don't worry, if we are not able to cover all these concepts in this session, we can have another session next Saturday and we'll complete the garbage collection. So my intention is to give the complete understanding of garbage collection, the role of garbage collection in performance testing for every performance engineer. So that is why the reason I did not directly start with what is garbage collection and how does it work. There are some other prerequisites that you have to understand before you go with garbage collection. So keep your questions aside in the last 10 minutes, because I have scheduled this meeting only for 2 hours. Okay. So if at all, if we are running out of time, we can continue the session next week as well. And we'll talk about the questions. Okay. Sorry for that. Please don't mind. Okay. So again, to debug all the GC memory issues, we will talk about later. First of all, I'll tell you what is garbage collection. What is garbage collection?
So collection of unreferenced objects.
Okay. Okay. Basically, garbage collection is nothing but I'll tell you in a very simple context. Basically, garbage collection is a simple mechanism which will have some automatic memory management technique. Okay, so if you take any of the application in C, right, if you take the programming in C, the memory management concept, automatic memory management concept, is not available actually. Okay, so the main benefit of JVM, Java JVM, is to have the GC, which is called garbage collector mechanism, and it has some its own unique different GC algorithms which will actually delete all the unused objects, unreferenced objects, or it will identify the objects which are no longer used. Okay, or if the object, if it completes its work, it will identify that object, it will mark that object as reachable, and all the unreachable objects will be deleted from the memory. This is what garbage collection will do. Okay, but whereas in the C++, you have to use malloc, realloc, and free, there are some methods to manually create an object, to destruct the object, to delete the memory. All these things are actually, those things will happen manually in all the C programming and C programming language. But whereas in Java, you have automatic memory management, which will completely remove objects that are not used or required anymore. Okay, live object is called reachable and the dead object is called unreachable. Okay, and for every object there is a function called system.gc or finalize method, or there are some other methods that are already there in the Eclipse IDE. Okay, in the Eclipse IDE you have system.jc and all other, but you may have a question, developer may have a question, I'm invoking a method system.jc at the end of every code snippet, why it is not garbage collected. Okay, so if the developer is giving system.gc method at the end of every code snippet, there is no guarantee that it will collect all the unused objects. That is why the reason garbage collection came into picture. So the automatic memory management with whatever the type of garbage collector that you use, it will act accordingly on the younger generation, older generation, meta space, and it will delete all the unused objects accordingly. Okay, basically it is necessary for freeing up the memory. Okay, so and all these Java programs, they compile to a bytecode, they run on a JVM, and when the program runs on this JVM, the objects create some memory. They are allocated onto a memory called heap, which is a portion of memory dedicated to the program. Again, memory, heap memory is different from the actual memory. Please remember this point. Okay, and when the program is running, eventually some of the objects are no longer required, so the garbage collector will find all the unused objects and removes all of them, and it will reclaim the memory. This is all about what is garbage collection. Now the second point is how the garbage collection will work. Okay, the programmer, if you take from the development side, the programmer need not explicitly mark which object has to be deleted. The garbage collection implementation will happen by default by the JVM itself. Each JVM will implement its own GC mechanism. Okay, you need no developer or no other person is actually defining it. Okay, although there are many JVMs in the market, as I told you, different types of JVMs, Hotspot JVM is the most commonly used. Okay, because it is very robust, and if you take a majority of the Java applications, they all sit on the Oracle Hotspot JVM. Okay, and you have basically the main advantage of this Oracle Hotspot JVM from JDK is you have multiple garbage collection algorithms, and each algorithm is unique for each requirement. For developer applications, you have one for standalone applications, you have serial GC. For high performance applications, you have G1C garbage first. For throughput, instead of focusing on response times, your objective is to focus on throughput. If your application is a batch job based application, where it has to process lot many jobs in an hour, where in such situations, the response times are actually ignored. You're focusing on the throughput. In that case, you'll be using this throughput collector. This is also called parallel collector. Same parallel GC collector is also called parallel old GC. Okay. The different garbage collection algorithms are serial garbage collector. Is parallel. It is also called as throughput collector, parallel old GC collector. The third one is called CMS, concurrent mark and sweep. And the fourth one is G1C. JDK 8, G1C algorithm is used. The reason is because, I'll tell it later. Again, there are a few other experimental collectors that are released. So far, many of you know these four collectors, right? Serial, parallel, CMS, and G1C. And you also have some other experimental collectors that are released from JDK 11, which are not completely implemented yet. Okay. The other one is ZGC. The name itself, ZGC collector. Okay. There is also called Epsilon. Okay. Epsilon collector. This is the epsilon collector is not completely implemented yet. This is called no garbage collector, no operation collector. It will not collect the garbage. So in future, if you take this epsilon garbage collector, right, this specific collector will be used for all the performance testing applications. If you want to know how much memory is actually used, okay, no garbage is collected. When no garbage is collected, if you run a test on a 64 GB machine with 50 users or 100 users, when no garbage is being collected, after completion of your test for 30 minutes or 45 minutes with 50 users, you will know how much actual memory is being consumed when 50 users are concurrently accessing my application for 1 hour. If the memory is full within 20 minutes or 25 minutes, the test will fail. That is a different story. But for to understand the memory footprint and how much amount of actual memory is occupied from your application with no garbage, you will be using epsilon garbage collector. This collector is already available from JDK 12. It is an experimental collector. You cannot do anything at the moment as there are so many changes that are happening continuously from release to release. And by end of this December 2020, all these collectors will be up and running, and you performance testing people, most of us will be using that collector. And the other collector, you have Shenandoah collector. I'll explain what each of them in detail. Okay, these are all the garbage collectors available. Okay, and as I have already explained you the different heap, the different generations that you have in heap memory, and you must be having so many questions. Okay, so many questions saying that, sir, do we have garbage collection mechanism in .NET as well? Do we have this heap memory in .NET applications? So like young generation, Eden generation, and other generations, do we have these memory areas? Yes, you have. In .NET applications, you have heap memory. Those are called SOH and LOH, small object heap and large object heap. Okay, objects less than 85 KB size will be stored in small object heap, and objects greater than 85 KB will be stored in large object heap. And if you take the heap memory, like young, older, and metaspace, you have three generations in CLR, like JVM in Java. One is generation 0, generation 1, and generation 2. Okay, the concept is similar, but that is a different part. At a very high level, I would like to let you know that the GC concept is the heap memory, the generations are all available in .NET as well. Okay, so if we talk about the benefits of Java garbage collection, the biggest benefit of garbage collection is automatically handling the memory management. Okay, the way it handles the deletion of unused objects, of all the objects that are not reachable, out of reach. Okay, so garbage collection is now a standard component of all the programming languages. No one is using the manual memory management concept. Very soon, I'm also assuming that C and other languages will also come up with something called auto memory management technique for better performance optimization in all their applications. Okay, if I talk about a situation like without garbage collection, that will be really a hectic task for every performance engineer. The reason is because, I mean, again, I'm seeing so many job roles very recently with the emerging tech stack that is coming up from various product based companies and services based companies across the globe. They keep asking so many things. You should have experience in Azure, Google Cloud, Salesforce Cloud, and you should be having Python, R programming, data science hands-on, Java hands-on. If you're having all of this, you'll be sitting somewhere in the Microsoft or Google, right? So job description, defining the style of defining the JD has completely changed. Okay, there are a lot many tools that are being involved in the performance testing JDs. Okay, you have all these things. You should know how to analyze GC, how to get this GC logs. What is that you really analyze from the GC log file? Okay, how do you analyze heap? How do you analyze thread? So even if he's a performance architect or any other technical manager, every client now is an under impression that I hired a skilled performance engineer, irrespective of any tech stack that I use in my architecture. It is Python, it is containerized based environment, it is Google Cloud, it is Azure. His assumption is something like the performance will engineer fix everything. That's not true. The role of a performance engineer here is he'll continuously monitor, he'll try to understand the basic areas of the code, and he will address all the performance issues that he sees in the test. The performance engineer will not be able to refactor the code, redesign the architecture. Okay, he cannot directly remove some of the external components that are creating huge performance impact on the applications. No performance engineer can do that. If someone, I have seen many people who are actually defining some stupid JDs. Sorry to use this word, but when the guy without having the actual experience on what performance testing and engineering will have, defining a JD and evaluating him in Java, Python, or data science concepts or Oracle DBA concepts will waste the associate time, and he will lose a skilled tester. That's the point. Okay, so when you face such interviews, you can directly educate the interviewer, because if you take many of the customers, if you take many of the product based companies, the engineering director, the software engineering director who is evaluating you, he himself doesn't even know what are all the roles and responsibilities that you will be a part of. So educate him directly. That's nothing wrong. You can directly tell him, this is what I can do, and this is what every performance engineer will do. Okay, so that is one case. And coming back to the Java garbage collection best practices for simple applications, okay, to complex applications, right? The developer or the programmers, they need not take some extra consider on how this garbage collection mechanism should work. I told you, right? This is a default mechanism. And programmers and performance engineers who want to advance their career in Java skills, it is very, very important to understand how the JVM will work, how the different garbage collections will work, how to analyze the GC log file, and all those stuffs. You can do it. So I told you, right? Everyone can write system.gc or runtime.gc in the end of the program, but there is no guarantee that it will collect the garbage at the end of, it will collect all the unused objects at the end of the program. That is why the reason you have some flags in JVM arguments. The best approach for tuning the Java garbage collection is you have to set some flags. For example, I go here, I already have my JDK installed on my machine. What does JDK installed on my machine mean? There is some JVM that is running on my machine. If I have Eclipse, if I'm running some programs here, what does it mean? It is already run. This bytecode information is running on where? The JVM. If you want to see which garbage collection is being used, you have to use this command line flags command. Okay. What is that you see here on the screen now?
Parallel JSON.
It is to understand the heap size. If you see the heap size here, this is the heap size initial. This is the max heap size. I'm not talking about this one. I don't want to the moment as we are talking. We just started with garbage collection. It is now using parallel GC algorithm for on your JVM. Got it? So for example, if I want to change this algorithm to G1 GC, right? You have to use this command Java hyphen, this is the JVM flag, all right? And you have to give command line flag, and you have to use this command. Okay, if I am giving this command, now it is using which GC?
G1 GC, shifted to G1 GC.
How you actually need to set, you can change your algorithm with this flags like this. Okay, if I can, I'm making it to Serial GC, and now it must be using Serial GC. Okay, this is one way of doing it. To know which JVM algorithm, Jarkaz collection algorithm is used, I'll share this to you, don't worry. So you have to go, you can directly go to the garbage collection, command line prompt of your machine, and you can check there. But many of you must be having some doubts, right? Sir, where is that I have to check my initial heap and max size? Okay. So in the WebLogic especially, okay, in the WebLogic, if you take, where is that you see, where you need to set XMS and XMX values, do you know? Where do you increase your heap?
JVM startup.
JVM argument.
No, no, you need to have some, you need to have some file, right? If it is in WebLogic, you need to have some file.
Not sure about WebLogic but for Tomcat, we have catalan.sh, and for JBoss, we have standalone.conf.
Yes, like that, you have many other tools.
WebLogic set startup environment file.
Hang on.
For Linux.
So there is a value called set domain env.cmd. Okay, you can directly go here from in the Oracle. You can directly go to the middleware, Oracle Home, User Projects, Domains, Base Domain, and the bin folder. If you go here, set domain.env command, this is where you will set the memory arguments. The XMS and XMS values are 512 MB, and XMS values are 1024 MB. Whenever you get the XMX values right, for example, you get some out of memory exception errors, you have to go here, and there are multiple files you can. Yes, you can change your algorithm as per your convenience, but again, it depends on your requirement. You cannot use directly one particular algorithm to your use case. The reason is because Serial GC will work only for the standalone applications, desktop applications. If you are using Serial GC for a distributed architecture, you will see high performance issues. Okay, so this is one way of increasing the heap. Just I wanted to show it to you. Okay. So
can you just share the path, where the file is located, because normally we go to the server config, just like in Tomcat. In the config file we change the arguments.
Okay, I'll share this path to you. Okay, I'll share this path after this session. Anyhow, I have to share some material to you, hopefully by tomorrow evening I'll send it. Okay, you'll get all this.
One more query. So as you said, for normal standalone machine, Serial GC we need to use, and how can we define that if it is a distributed architecture?
Yeah, I'll tell you, because we did not discuss about the algorithms. I'll clearly explain all the algorithms. Okay. So if I talk about the performance impact of GC, the main important issues that you see are high response times. Okay. And if you give the low, if your heap size is very low, what does it happen? The number of GC cycles on your heap will increase. The GC frequency will come very often, and at every time it will create stop the world events. It will literally halt the application. It will suspend, terminate all your threads. And the same time which has been sent at that point of time, this time gets added to the end user response time. Again, which will give you some 20 plus or 15 plus seconds of response time, which is not at all acceptable. Okay, so high CPU utilization, high memory utilization, some abnormal behavior from the application. Okay, so different activities that you have from your application, all these things basically will happen just because of the GC. Okay. So the number of GC cycles that happens on the application will directly impact the performance of your application, and you have to measure how much impact, okay? How much impact you really have on the application is basically measured depending upon the nature of your application, what type of activity that it does, and the type of GC algorithm that you choose, okay? And the good news about GC algorithm is, with every JDK release, right, the the Java is coming up with some of the new GC collectors with high performance improvements, so that it will avoid many of the performance issues. Okay, and I told you, right, the new garbage collectors are Epsilon garbage collector, ZGC, and the last one is Shenandoah. Basically, Java 11 introduced Epsilon and Z garbage collector algorithms. And I told you, Epsilon is a no operation garbage collector. It means that it will not perform any garbage. But the purpose of the main purpose of this Epsilon garbage collector is to understand how much of actual memory consumption was there on your application. Okay, so the Shenandoah garbage collector, like ZGC and Epsilon garbage collector released in Java 11, Java 12 released Shenandoah garbage collector. Basically, this manages large heap times, and the main importance of this garbage collection is it manages, it has very lower pause times. Okay, and you cannot manage the memory explicitly manually. The reason is because if you are trying to manage the memory, that is why the reason you will see so many issues from the applications that are developed in C++. Because of the memory or manual memory management, there is a high possibility of memory leaks. There is some concept of dangling references. Okay, for example, a programmer wants to deallocate the memory of a specific object which is being used by another object, and for some reason he is deleting the original object, it will show you some unexpected behavior, right? So he has to manually identify which objects are not really using the memory. He has to identify all of them, and then again he has to free the memory of that object. By any chance, by mistake, if he is deleting the original object which is already having some references, then you will see some unexpected behavior in the application. Okay, so basically the garbage collection, if you talk about the involvement of garbage collection involves basically in three steps. One is the marking, and the second one is
sweeping.
Yeah, I'm just searching for the notepad. Okay, the first one is marking phase. The second one is
sweeping.
And the third one is compaction. Okay, so I'll tell you about the mark phase first. It is the first phase the garbage collection will walk through the object graph. Okay, there are something called GC roots. GC roots is the place of the origin. This is where the references starts from. Everything starts from GC roots. Okay, all the variables, JNA variables, local variables, some of the declarations, these are all called GC roots. All are part of GC roots. So in the first step, in the marking phase, the GC will walk through the object graph, starts from the GC root node. Okay, it will check for all the objects which has some references to multiple objects, and it marks all the objects which are reachable. It will mark the objects which are reachable, and it will mark them as live. Right? The second phase called delete or sweep. In the delete step, okay, whichever the objects are not reachable, are dead, are no longer being used, or unreferenced. Ignore that message. So, delete sweep phase, whichever the object is reachable, we'll rephrase it, whichever the objects are reachable, they are not touched. And all the unreferenced, unreachable, dead objects are deleted by the garbage collector, and it will reclaim the memory. So what is the last phase? The compaction. So in the compaction, I think the session will end in another 10 minutes. Okay, but again,
You can continue.
I think Zoom is extended for unlimited time. You will get a notification.
No, this is a commercial version, but I have scheduled this meeting only for 2 hours. That's fine. I'll you can join again. That's no issues, right? You don't have any issues if I'm taking some time.
Yeah, no issues.
If you have some time, I mean, if you have some work or something, you can just drop. I'm recording this session. Okay, so let me go back to one of the article because I have clearly mentioned there. I want to tell you what I want to make you understand what is this garbage compaction step is very, very important step. So so if you see, this is the part, okay? Allocation will happen like this. After freeing the objects, this is what will happen. Did you see after the freeing the objects? That is the delete, sweep and step. Do you see the after compaction step? What is the compaction doing?
It's something like defragmentation in the disk space.
The basic level, what it will do is, it is bringing all the utilized memory to the left-hand side, and it is bringing all the free memory to the right hand side. So whatever the memory blocks that are available in the grid randomly, they are arranged in order. This is a very high level. Definition says a lots of things. Again, fragmentation part and all of these steps, okay? This is the most crucial step because GC will spend most of its time in compacting this memory. Compaction is a very high consuming task. Whichever the high GC time that you see, right, that the time is actually taking that in the compaction. You got it? So there is another step. Many of the people will ask you an entry question. Why should I use G1C garbage first? Why should I use G1C when I have serial GC, parallel GC, concurrent mark and sweep? Why should I use my G1C? Now every performance engineer or Java developer writes a code. By default, they are using G1C. The main advantage of G1C is it will not wait for young generation to be full, old generation to be full, and permgen to be full. Garbage first itself is saying whichever the area generation is full, it directly goes to that area and it will perform the garbage collection. There is no sequence. Whichever area of the memory is getting impacted, is it getting full, it will go there, it will perform GC. It will make the memory available for the other objects that are coming in. Okay, so that you will have some available space and it will the chance of getting out of memory exceptions are very, very less. That is one use case. And the second advantage, there is one advantage. The second main advantage of G1C, using G1C collector, is that the time that it is taking for compaction compared to other collectors is very, very less. So it will have some less impact on the application performance, right? If the compaction is taking too much of time, then it'll give you the high response times. So whatever the time that G1C is spending on GC compaction step is very, very less when you use G1C collector. All right. So in this article, I have clearly written how the object allocation, how the reference to objects, object aging, promotion will happen. So these are the use cases for all the GC algorithms. For example, I told you, right, serial garbage collector, it uses only single thread. It is default collector for client class platforms, 32 bit, 64 bit also. But again, this also stops all the threads for both minor GC and full GC. Okay, the use case is if you want to avoid the low pass, if it is a single CPU environment, if you have a very small heap, few hundred MBs, okay, several GCs, several JVMs running on single platform, you should use this one. You can go through this article, but about all of this part, the use cases I have clearly mentioned here on a very detailed understanding. Okay, so but we'll refer another article. This one we'll refer to talk about all that stuff.
Sir, I have one query. So for G1 GC, is there any minimum heap requirement? I mean that we should have at least 4 GB of heap memory for the better performance like that.
You have requirements. I close the. Oh my God. Okay. You have a case. Yes. I'll tell you the business cases. Okay. We are to discuss about that. Yeah. I'll tell you the business case.
Before going deep, can you just quickly explain about the kinds of memory that we are using, like the physical memory and the heap memory, and so the JVM memory and the heap memory that we use for allocating the heap size?
No, we'll do one thing. We will set up a separate meeting for the memory basics. So most of us still don't know what is the cache memory, what is the buffer memory, or what is the physical memory, what is the virtual memory. So that is a very different concept. But here you have to remember one strong best practice for now. 1/64th size of your initial heap is 1/64th size of physical memory is your initial heap, 1/4th of your physical memory is maximum heap, and there is no standardized formula or guidelines to set up this heap. Depending upon the nature of your application, depending upon the object allocation rate, the object creation rate, object destruction rate, all these parameters are considered before you define a heap. Okay, so there is no one standardized strategy, GC heap strategy, to define all of them, but it depends with lot many parameters, and all of them will be discussed in the design part of your performance engineering when the application is developed. Okay, so that's a different concept, but I have clearly written all the use cases. You can go through and you can come back to me anytime. I'll leave my number and I'll leave my LinkedIn here. You can come back to me for all your questions that you have. And I have clearly mentioned here, and these are all the three steps that we are talking. It involves in three steps. Again, I just wanted to repeat: the mark phase, the delete sweep phase, and compaction phase. Okay, what mark phase is doing is, this is the first step where the GC will walk through the object node graph right from the beginning. It starts from the GC root nodes. It will go through all the object references that it has to multiple objects and mark all the objects that are reachable. What it will mark? It will mark all the objects as live, and it will delete all the remaining objects. That is the next step. Now, if we talk about the delete and sweep, whichever the objects are reachable, they are not touched, and all the unreachable objects are deleted, and it will reclaim the memory. Okay. The compaction step is the crucial step. It's the process of arranging everything in order. We have all these blocks. Okay. We have, after deletion, we have all these blocks randomly available in the grid, in the memory grid. I show you here. So you see the blue color ones and white color ones. So to bring all of them into order, to arrange the free memory space and the used memory space in an order, this compaction will take care of that activity. It will identify all the randomly reachable objects in the grid. Okay, where we don't have continuous allocation. So it will identify all of them. To avoid all this fragmentation and all, the compaction will be done to arrange everything in order. Okay, this is compaction step.
Yeah, I have one question, please, regarding this mark, sweep, and compact. Does it happen at every type of GC, or does it differ? This mark, compact, and
this applies to the current GC algorithms that we are using. So if we talk in depth, every GC algorithm, minor GC, it will happen mark. Okay, minor GC, it will happen mark and sweep. Some of them will have mark and copy. For example, minor GC, it will have mark, sweep, and compact. In the major GC, it will run mark and copy. So there are there are again different algorithms. I'm referring to that article. If you see here, so the mark, sweep and compaction, again you have different algorithms. The first one is mark and copy, and the mark, sweep and copy. Okay, most of the algorithms in minor GC, the mark and copy will happen. Sorry, not in the minor GC. In the young generation, the mark and copy will happen. In the major generation, in the older generation of your heap, the mark, sweep and compact algorithm will happen in many of the cases. Okay, so this is in depth of each and every garbage collection algorithm, which area of heap is using which algorithm. Okay, these are the algorithms, the way they work in the generations. These are collectors, the serial collectors, which collector you have to use. If you are using this collector right, in each collector, in young generation, it will use mark and copy. In old generation, it will use mark, sweep and compact. Many of the collectors will have the same mechanism. Okay. So if I talk about the GC tuning, you are actually the first step to tune. What you do is, every performance engineer will increase the size of the heap. This is not because of heap is too small. It is because of many GCs that are creating a problem on your application. The high GC frequency, or if the developers are creating temporary objects, too many temporary objects. If the objects are, if the developers are creating too many references, too many unnecessary objects. Okay. And if your heap memory is limited, and if some of the objects are duplicated, okay, if your GC algorithm, many of the times GC will fail to identify the objects which are not reachable, it will not able to reclaim the memory. So all this happens because of the inefficient code, inefficient design. Okay. In order to avoid all these parameters, the developers has to be extra cautious in defining the heap. Okay, basically they should avoid creating too many unnecessary objects. Place your call on mute, please, everyone. All right, thanks, thank you. So okay, developers has to be extra cautious in creating excess number of duplicate objects. Okay, and they have to avoid creating temporary objects. They have to create they have to follow other best practices to avoid all the GC issues. Okay, GC will directly impact the response times. Okay, GC will directly impact the resource utilizations, and it will impact the CPU memory, the response times of your transactions, and also it would reduce overall application throughput. Okay, you will not be getting the throughput. Okay, so if the JVM is experiencing memory pressure, and for example, if the JVM itself is identifying that so much of pressure, memory pressure is being created with too much of GC, so what it will do, it will continuously increase the heap until the memory pressure dissolves, right? So once it reaches the maximum heap size, it will start throwing you the out of memory and all. But and if your memory pressure is low, the JVM can decide, okay, depending upon the memory pressure of your GC, the JVM, now the recent releases, it can decide to reduce the pause times by shrinking the heap size. Depending upon the memory pressure, object allocation rate, the JVM internally itself, what it can do for you is, it will shrink the heap size. Okay, this process is called adaptive sizing. Okay, it's not adjusting the overall heap, but it is setting the size and ratio of all the young and old generations. So to enable this adaptive sizing policy, if you want to use this internal technique, which will be automatically taken care by JVM to manage the excess usage of GC, you have to use one flag called, I'm not sure Okay, you have to use one flag called -X6. I'm not sure if this is correct, but I'm sure about the name. Okay, but you can cross check. Adaptive size policy. If you're setting this to true in your JVM, so it will take care of the memory pressures. If it is high or if it is low, it will shrink the generations. It will shrink the heap size. It will reduce, increase the heap size accordingly during the process. And this process is called adaptive sizing. When you set this parameter to true, it is not just increasing the overall heap or reducing the heap. It is taking care of complete the size and ratio of all the young, old and perm generations. Okay, this is called that policy. So this is one of the performance engineering question. Can I internally manage my excessive GC? If so, how can I manage it? Okay. And as I told you, the maximum heap size should not exceed the amount of physical memory that you have on your system. And if you have multiple JVMs running, the sum of max heap sizes should not exceed the machine's physical memory. You can look at the GC log. You can take a GC log, full GC log, and you can see, you can observe how memory is being used, how long the GC has run, or the GC has taken to impact your performance and all of the stuff. Okay. So this is all about GC. If now I talk about the GC roots, right? Every time after your completion of your test, you have to clean all your LGs or you have to clean all your other memory areas. The reason is because you will have so many temporary objects that are created in your cache memory or some other areas of the memory again, which will impact the performance of your test. And it's not really a best practice to run a performance test. For example, if you're running a test for 3 hours now, you need to give a break a minimum of 45 minutes. You need to bring the load generators to idle state and you need to clean up all the memory. You need to empty your memory. Implementing GC strategy task will not happen from the performance engineering or testing teams, but there are few design architects, application architects who will be taking care of what is the state of local variables or how many threads, the static fields, the duplication, the GNI references, all will be discussed in the code reviews as part of performance engineering best practice. Every sprint, it will go with some 2 to 3 coding practices, coding reviews. And GC log file, I don't think so. I mean, how many of you have taken the GC log file? How many of you got an opportunity to take some GC log files? But in the GC log file, you can see all these things. Okay. For now, I can tell you one simple example on how you can see the GC activity. Okay. In a real time, I have an Eclipse. Okay. I have an Eclipse and I have some programs which will create some memory leak in memory leak. Okay. So what I did was, I have a JProfiler that is installed on my machine. If you want to profile the code directly here from the JProfiler, the first thing that you have to do is you have to go to the session. Okay. And IDE integrations. If you go to IDE integrations, you have to select the IDE. If it is an IntelliJ or Eclipse or anything, you can select here and you can integrate. But here, what I did was I have already integrated. And if you install the JProfiler, right, you will get some demo servers. Before doing that, I would like to think. I have got so many questions, I guess. It's 9:10, but it is still continuing. No worries, right? It's fine if I go ahead for another 30 minutes?
Yes.
All right. The recording will be shared. We'll talk about the questions, okay? Hang on, please. So if this is from the very basic level, okay? If it is a very basic level, you integrate with the IDE and you see what is really happening. Okay. Submission. Let me remove the duplicate instances. Okay, if JDBC demo is server, you have some default servers, it will start the program for you, and this is how you can monitor. Okay, this is a default, this is a simple simulation. You can see the GC activity here, right? You can see the threads, you can see the CPU. And if you go to threads, you can see the thread monitor, the thread diagrams, the thread maps, you can see all of them here. If I click here, it will directly take a thread dump. The same way, if you go to heap dump, and if you click on heap snapshot, you can take the heap snap and you can analyze directly from the heap hero.io. And the same thing for fastthread.io, you can take the thread dump and you can do it. If you go to the telemetries and you can see the memory, how it is being allocated and what is happening with this stuff. Okay, if at some point, if you see that the memory is continuously increasing, and if you think that GC is not running, you can simply click on this run GC, it will perform the GC, and you can see the spike here. The GC is performed, and now the memory, if you see the drop here, it has freed some memory. If you can see the minor change here, the some fall here. Okay, so I'll close this at the moment. So, and the same way, you have some of the code snippets like this. I have already connected. What I did was, I have already created one. I have one code snippet. So what I can do is sample thread lock, that I can simply click on. Hang on, I'm profiling my application. As I have already integrated, it is opening JProfiler directly, if you see here. Okay, there are various things that you can, there are various ways, n number of tools to monitor all your activities. Okay, so what this particular thing will do is, you can create your own lab setup. You can find some of the code snippets, and you can see here. Okay, many of you must be having so many questions on how the deadlocks are created. If you see, the running threads are 0, total number of threads are 3, the waiting threads are 3, now the waiting threads are 4. And if I'm going continuously here, if I'm moving my graph, waiting threads are 7. And if you go continuously here, the blocked threads, you see, you have 3 blocked threads. Now, if you want to know what is that you really have in the thread history, you have to go to the current locking graph. If you go to the current locking graph, what do you understand from here? This thread 3 has locked the object 3. The thread 1 has locked the monitor, sorry, the object 1. The thread 2 has locked the object 2. So basically, every thread, when it is running, right, it has to obtain a lock in an object to complete that activity. And it has to release that object for the remaining threads to continue execution. But here, the thread is obtaining a lock on an object and it is not releasing the lock. That is why the reason you have a deadlock. So all these kind of issues you can see by using JProfiler. Okay. Likewise, you have many other tools that I have integrated with IDE for now. And you will be, sir, this is okay. This is like we are doing it in the IDE part. But how do I integrate my JProfiler to my application server? Okay, if in your real time, when the load test is happening, you go here, you go to the start center, and you click on new session. You go to the new server integration. You go to the WebLogic. If my server is WebLogic, oh my God. Okay, if I click my WebLogic 12C server, you have to, on a remote computer, if you have, you have to select this one. Okay, and you have to click on next, and you have to select the JVM vendor, JRocket, and or if you are, it is an Oracle, you have to select, select the version of it. To select, and you have to give the integration. Okay, this is how you do the integration on a server in a production on your test environments. Okay, so if you keep this aside, if I go here, we have so many questions coming up, but we'll talk. No, it's a trial version, and there are many other tools come up with the JDK. Okay. So if I go here, you can do one thing. What you can do is, allow me a minute. You can Java. Okay, you can go to this Java official site. Okay, you can go to this demo, and you have so many applications like this. If you have 3D viewer, right? This is a direct jar file. Let me open this for you. This is a sample application. So we will open this jar file. Let us see. So this command, what it is doing is I'm setting the -xmx values. This one is 10 MB. I'm giving a very less sizes, and I'm trying to execute this jar directly from my command line interface. Okay, if I am doing this one, okay, initial heap. What? Okay, cool. So the application was opened now. Okay, if you can, how you can monitor GC is what I'll show you. Okay, you can directly go to program files, you can go to Java, and what I'll open for you is my system is slow, sorry for the inconvenience. Okay, I am opening my JVisual VM here. If you want to see all the activity of JVisual VM, what is that you have to do? Now this 3D viewer is running. I'm opening this one, but before, if you want to open this one, right, go to tools, go to plugins, and in the available plugins you will be seeing Visual GC. Okay, you have to, I have already installed, that is why the reason it is not showing here. Okay, you go here, click on installed. A Visual GC plugin is what I already have installed, and these are all the system properties you can see, and the JVM arguments that I have given for my program to run. Okay, you can monitor all the activities here, the CPU, the heap space, meta space. You can also perform GC forcefully using this utility. You can take a heap dump. You can just click on heap dump to see the heap dump, what heap dump it has been generated. Okay. The same way, you can also create a thread dump. If you click on thread dump, it will create a thread dump and it'll show you the thread dump. Okay. You can go to the instrumentation part from the sampler. You can go to the profiler and see. And most importantly, we have installed Visual GC to monitor this activity. What is that? Can you tell me what is happening here?
Objects are getting created in the young space, I mean Eden space. Some are getting promoted to survivor.
Right. So you are seeing the GC time. Your GC, you are seeing the 20 collections happened. Your GC, you are seeing the GC time that it has taken. Last cause, heap finish, heap dump. And if you see the sawtooth pattern, right? If you see a small spike here, GC happened, and that is why the reason the memory is freed here. The spike indicates the GC happened. And if you see the histogram, what is this 15 boxes that are showing here?
Those are the max tenuring threshold, means when to promote the objects from young to old.
So after the object getting survived in young generation for 15 cycles, that is called max tenuring threshold. If the object is surviving 15 cycles of minor GCs, okay, garbage collections, it will be promoted or it will be moved, shifted from young generation to older generation. You can also set this tenuring threshold by using a JVM argument called max tenuring threshold. Okay, you can also have this refresh rate. This is one thing. Okay. So you also have JMC. JMC is a very good tool actually, but there is from the latest releases of JDK. JDK has a built-in option called flight recorder. I don't know how many of you are aware of this one. This flight recorder. I'm just trying to record something. Let us stop this one. Let us see how why this is. I'll stop my program and we'll reinitiate the program.
But this JMC is it's a paid tool, right? It's
yes. I mean, but for some of the few code snippets, if you want for learning purpose and all, if you want to know what this flight recorder JMC will do, it's a commercial version basically. So to if you want to see what it will really do for you, you can use this one. I'll tell you how to what it will show. I'll tell you. Okay. So let us open this JMC. Let us change.
Alabaksh, please go on mute, please.
Or else let me mute from okay, cool. There is some exception, I don't know, but
Radhakrishna, so this jar we need to provide into the server config, right, in order to get the metrics of each and every.
No, see, if you go to the site, right? Okay, we'll talk in the next session. This one JMC, we have to find out that. But JMC is a very good visualization tool, so it will give you all the information. Till yesterday, but I don't know what exception it is giving. But again, we'll continue with JMC, and. Yeah, you need not import any of the applications or jar files in the Java.
Yeah, that is required. Oracle. You need to configure it with the particular server. So that is after thing, but it should open.
Yeah, actually, you have all this demo jar files and all. You can directly run it from the command prompt. Okay. And you have so many applications in the GitHub sample Java applications, you can compile that code. In that case, when you completely put that into a jar file, that is required to deploy or configure it to the server on whichever you're testing. Okay.
But for the performance, right, it will also create an overhead on the server if we install this agent in order to get a metrics, right, in the real time.
Which one?
This JMC, if we are getting a profile of any metrics any server, right?
Basically, whatever the utilities on Java are doing at the moment currently, right? All these things are now handled by Dynatrace or APM. Now, for example, from the CA APM, right? Now we are supporting all these metrics. You need not use the Java monitoring. That was the latest release, some 10.x was there, right? CA APM. So it is giving all these things. It will capture all the GC cycles, GC phases, GC pause times, everything it will capture. It will have hundreds of metrics. Again, it's depends again how you deal with all the metrics for your performance. Instead of, as you said, instead of having all these things on the server, you can install single agent. Okay, you also have Dynatrace one agent concept irrespective of any server, any tech stack, any application. It will help, it will capture everything with all the metrics that we are configuring onto the target servers that we want to monitor. But again, it depends on the pay model. Okay, the pay models are huge. They're very much expensive if you want to monitor everything in specific. If you see here, it is also giving you the garbage collector, right? It is copy collections, 9 collections you have, total time spent, mark sweep compact, 1 collection in the major GC, total time spent, all these things you'll see. Okay, so now the last concept is we'll discuss about which algorithm to use when. Okay, if you look at the serial GC, right? Serial GC, basically it will, as I told you, it will talk about the minimal requirements. If you take any of the single CPU environments, or if you have a very small memory footprint, and it uses single thread to run all the both minor and major GC collection. Okay, and there is a bump pointer technique for compaction, but that is not required. But for our use cases, if I have clearly written one case here, if you have a quad core CPU and 4 applications are running, if the garbage collection is not single threaded, and if it is a multi-threaded one, okay, garbage collector will try to garbage all the areas of all the applications that they're using, right? On all the 4 cores of the CPU, it will utilize the entire CPU. So when you have a multi-based kind of environment setup where you have some multiple applications are running, using this serial garbage collector, advantage is you will have the other applications that are running along with the existing application will suffer because it is utilizing everything, right? So basically the garbage collector, serial garbage collector, you have to use for low pass requirements and for a very single based environment and all. Okay, if you go to hello, my minute, I'm getting a call. I'll just stop it. Give me 1 second, please. I'm sorry. Sorry for the long hold. Yeah. So, I'm sorry. So, if you take the GC algorithm serial garbage collector, right? This is a default collector for all the client class platforms, especially the use for the 32-bit JVMs on a Windows or a single processor machines, okay, where you have one CPU. And it uses only one single thread to process all the heap. And again, it also has stop the world events happening. It will suspend all the threads for both minor and major GC. Okay. And the use case, you must be knowing when you have to use the serial garbage collector. Okay. So basically, if you want to have low pass requirements, if you have a one single environment using only one application, and if it is having very less heap, only hundreds of MB, okay? And if you have only one JVM, you have to use this one, all right? So if you have multiple applications that are running on the JVM or multiple JVMs that are running, this will not help, especially for the performance testing. We will not use this collector at all. Okay, if I go to the throughput collector, this is also called parallel old collector, sorry, parallel GC collector or parallel old garbage collector. So it uses multiple threads to perform GC on both minor and major GC, and this does not run concurrently. So, and the name, it will not do anything with it. I mean, it is just because it has multiple threads of the garbage collection, and the threads will run parallelly, but the garbage collection is not running parallelly on both minor and major GCs. Okay, so it will also have, most of the times this collector will be used. Okay, this is the default collector for a multi CPU environment and for 64-bit JVM machines. And it will, as I said, to gain the speed or to minimize the process, you can use this application threads. I mean, you can use multiple threads to perform GC. Okay, now we must be having a question. What is the difference between use parallel GC and use parallel old GC? If you're selecting parallel GC, it enables multi-threaded collection of young generation and single-threaded generation for old generation. It will use single thread in old, okay, for use parallel GC. But if you use parallel old GC, it will enable the multi-threading collection for both young and older generation of your heap. Okay, so the main advantage of this collector is, in the very short period of time, it will collect the highest amount of garbage by using this collector. Okay, and it will have the stop the world events happening, and for many of the batch process based applications, for volume testing, instead of focusing on response times, if you want to focus on throughput, where you are ignoring the response times, you are ensuring that all the data that we have done from the front end is stored in the database. All these activities will happen in batch job based testing, right? For all the batch job based performance testing activities, you have to use parallel GC, and this is also called parallel collector. Okay, so the use cases I told you, right? It is always the multi CPU, and if you want to have the larger heap. Basically, if you're doing a job-based performance testing where you're processing huge number of jobs, you will need a large heap, right? So the third one is CMS. This is called concurrent mark and sweep collector. So specifically designed to avoid the long process associated with full GC cycles. Okay. Again, it stops all the threads during minor and major GCs. And what basically happens when you use this algorithm is, it will use a different algorithm to collect in younger generation. That means in the younger generation, it will use parallel GC. Okay. And in the older generation, it will use CMS. You have to remember this difference. In the CMS, it will use a different algorithm, parallel GC algorithm, in younger generation of your heap. And in older generation, it will use the CMS. Okay. So the CMS is also called a low pass collector. So it will not perform any of the compaction. That is one of the main disadvantage of it. In case of any of the CPU availability or heap fragmentation, again, it will go back to the serial collector, and it will switch to serial collector by default. Okay, and the last point is, this CMS collector will not collect anything from PermGen, which is called non-heap memory. It will collect only young and old generations. If you want to have low pass requirements on the available CPUs, in case of single CPU machines, you can use incremental mode and other stuff. You can use this CMS. Is it better now?
Yeah.
Toilet. Sorry about that. Yeah. So if I talk about the G1 collector, as I told you, the G1 collector is designed to process large heaps. If your heap is more than 4 GB with minimal process, you can use this garbage first. And this heap is automatically divided into separate regions and it will perform the compaction. Okay. The way it performs the compaction in G1C collector is it will copy the data between the regions so that it will not delete the objects which are all which still has some reference to it. So by mistake or unknowingly or knowingly, it should not delete any of the object which holds some reference, right? If it is doing that, you will be seeing some unexpected behavior in the application, or there is a possibility of seeing some exceptions or something like that. So there is some kind of compaction from both all the generations of the heap. So even in the compaction, it will copy the data between the regions. Okay. So, and you must be having so many questions. These are all the 4 garbage collectors which are widely used. Okay, till JDK 8, most of us from the performance testing or engineering are not aware of the remaining collectors. As I told you, there is one more collector called Shenandoah collector. This is an improvement of G1 collector. Okay, so this is an experimental collector. So it has some higher footprint. It has some, it also optimizes the latencies. So if you have a low latency, low POS requirements, if it is working same as G1C, that means, which means not worried about which area is getting full and then it has to garbage. It is immediately taking an action on whichever area is getting full and it is freeing up the memory. So this is an advanced version of G1 and this isn't still an experimental collector. Most of the applications, the new applications that are starting right from the scratch, now they're planning to use this collector. Okay. So GC POS times will be less. It will optimize the latency. And this is all about Shenandoah. You can also set this option by using this one. Use Shenandoah, you can set it. But make sure that you're using above JDK 8, at least JDK 11 or something. Okay. The last one is this is the one we are talking about, Epsilon collector. Okay. This is introduced in JDK 11. This is called JDK's do nothing collector, no operation collector. The reason is because it will not garbage any of the regions, any of the areas of your heap. It will not clear the memory at all. Okay. So it will just give you how much actual memory is being allocated for your test if you're running it for 1 hour. How many objects are created? Which area is occupying with what amount of what percentage of memory? Okay. Basically, if you see here, I have clearly highlighted the Epsilon GC has added as a benchmark to test the application for performance, memory usage, latency, and throughput improvements. Okay, it is basically trying to measure how long the JVM is taking to shut down. Once the memory is getting filled up with all the objects, if you run a test for 1 hour or 30 minutes with 50 users by default, if the JVM is shutting down, it is saying that the objects with 50 users for a very short period of time, a lower duration load test, it is doing that, right? So the Epsilon GC feature is disabled by default. This is an also experimental collector. You can also use it and see what is really happening, but this is not yet stable. And there are lot many changes that are happening from release to release, from patch to patch upgrades, all those stuff. So the last one is the jet garbage collector. Basically, I told you, right, for the applications which are developed right from scratch, they are developed on JetGC. This is not completely stable again. Okay. So, for example, the main advantage of this GC, I'll tell you, if you have a GC pause time of 10 seconds or 5 seconds, you can instruct your JVM using a parameter called, you can limit the,
max GC pause.
Max GC time. Okay, the GC pause time, there is one JVM argument, I think I did not mention it here. So there is one metric where you can directly instruct your JVM to use only that 10 milliseconds to perform GC positive, to wait for that GC. So that is the only, the main advantage of this one. And the stop the world events will be minimized a lot. The latency will be minimized. The throughput will be increased. The response times are optimized. When you have all this stuff, everything will be optimized by using a JetGC. But these are all experimental collectors. Do not worry about it. You can use, you can understand till Z1C. Okay. And the last topic of discussion is, which garbage collection to choose depends upon the nature of your application, the object allocation rate, okay, the application that you're testing, the memory footprints are required, the number of CPUs, the entire architecture that you have, if you have batch jobs involved, okay, if you have so much of throughput that is concentrated in your SLA, or if you have too many web app DB servers, where your application is supporting the business for 100 plus countries. In such cases, you have to be very careful. Before you decide on which GC algorithm that you have to use. Okay. So these are all, this is all about GC algorithms. And the last point of discussion from performance testing point of view is, every time I keep asking the same question, what are the reasons for high CPU utilization? What are the high reasons for high memory utilizations? What are the high reason? What are the main reasons for high response times? The memory started falling down in the middle of the test. The memory all of a sudden started increasing. I have observed a bump. Okay. So why are all these things happening? The main reason is because whenever the GC is happening, GC will directly, literally stop, suspend, okay, terminate all the threads from executing. It will halt the application and it will make the application available to the users. If the same thing is happening in your load test, this particular activity at this point of time will create all these bumps, all these unexpected behaviors in all the graphs, okay? So, all the graphs. So, is it better now? Oh my god, okay.
Yeah, it's fine.
So every time you see a high response time, don't if you see a high CPU utilization, high memory utilization, vertical scaling, horizontal scaling will not improve the performance. Go back, look at your JVM, identify the number of GC cycles, the minor GCs, major GCs, all of the stuff. Keep an eye on the monitoring part and go to the GC log file, and you have to take a log file. You have a JVM argument for that to take the GC log file. You can size the generations. You can increase the XMS, XMX values, but you have to keep an eye on the physical memory, and you have to continuously monitor the GC when an object in young has moved, when an object in old has moved, and how much time it has taken, and when the stop the world event has taken place, and how long the GC ran. All these questions are required, okay, to see or to know what really happened with high response times and all. For example, when is the full GC ran? Okay, how many minor GCs has ran? Did they run repeatedly? If they're running repeatedly, in what interval they have ran? Okay, after the GC is completed, you have to measure how much memory is reclaimed in young, old, and permanent generations, and how long this GC has run. Okay, how long did JVM pause when full GC is happening? What is the total allocated memory in each generations? How many objects or the percentage of objects that are promoted to old generation? Again, from older generation, the percentage of objects that are promoted to metaspace or permgen. So all these things you will understand by generating a GC log file. Okay, you have parameters for that. And if you think, if any one of you think if anything is missing from our session, we'll again log in the next Saturday for another hour, and we'll talk about JMC and we'll talk about the GC log file. All right.
Thanks, Chris. One question. Okay. So if there is any issue with the GC collection, right? Will it impact the CPU as well?
Yes. It's a direct impact.
Direct impact.
Okay. Direct impact on CPU and memory will happen from the GC pause time. No doubt about it.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. So, yeah, thanks. And the next class, next session, right? Will you be able to actually walk through us through the GC log file?
Yeah, because my intention of taking this session is to complete basic to advanced concepts from GC algorithms. So that is why the reason we can have another session planned for the next week. We'll complete all the GC. We'll also talk about all the performance GC performance bottlenecks and how to fine tune them. And we'll work with some of the applications. And like something like this, you can go to the Eclipse, and I have some. We can run some of the memory leak demo. This is a pro code snippet. If you run this one right, after some time, you will be seeing out of memory exception error. So when you see out of memory exception error, you will be seeing GC cycles and all other stuff. We'll go to JMC and we'll see all of them. All right.
Yeah.
So, Radha Krishna. Yes, sorry. A small query. For example, in horizontal scaling, if we have multiple app servers, so then how can we get all the GC cycles and memory usage? So if how it does? Is in one server, we can use JProfiler.
No, basically. Yeah. Sorry for interrupting. Basically, you will have a very high configured servers running with multiple JVMs. You can monitor all of them in one place. Or if you you can also monitor all the different application servers. That is also possible. So, but you have to monitor each of them individually. The reason is because if you're monitoring all of them together, right, you'll not be able to pinpoint or identify the issue. So you have to break that into bits and pieces for better visibility to understand. Okay. And I would like to add one more point here. This is one of the code snippet, a memory allocation part. If you see the memory here, do you see this one? The memory is continuously increasing. The allocated memory is continuously growing. And if you see the GC activity, 60%. If you see here 92.5, if you see 99.49, it means that the GC is really suffering, struggling a lot to clear the memory, to clear all the unused objects from the memory area. That is why the reason you are not seeing the sawtooth pattern here. For example, if you see, it has to go like this, it has to come down, it has to go like this, you have to see some multiple triangles. You have to see the drops of the reclaiming the memory. So when the GC is struggling here, do you see the CPU load? You see the CPU load, the system load, it is going directly to 67.2. The system load is going to 97.8. And again, you see the 100% GC activity here. The GC is continuously growing. But just wanted to show it to you. Yeah. Any other questions you have?
So what is, what is this JVM CPU bund?
Sorry?
We see one matrix, right? JVM CPU bund. So what does it mean?
Where is it?
In AppDynamics, for example, we see that, right? JVM
analysis. It is instances of JVMs that are running on your application. You'll have multiple JVMs, right? They are the instances. So they're actually identified in different ways. AppDynamics will talk in a different way with a different terminology. CA APM will talk directly the instance one, instance two. It will talk with the instances and it has the ability to monitor all the JVMs in one place. You will see the boxes and grids. You can monitor each of every individual JVM there. And again, each of JVM will have a separate list of GC metrics.
Okay. And one more question, nowadays many organization are moving from the monolithic to mostly the microservices architecture, right? Where the concept of pods and container. So, and where in microservices we are always expecting more throughput and less latency. Okay. So based on your experience, like how, which GC algorithm will suit best, or sorry, the collector?
It's always for now, for better performance, considering all the stability, scalability factors in terms of performance, throughput, latency, everything. G1C is the best collector actually, any environment if you take.
Okay.
Okay, because if you take the monolithic architecture is different. If you take the microservices architecture, you never know when a service will be full with the memory, with the unused objects. The G1C has to identify each of the service which is getting filled. It has to walk through all the different memory regions, and it has to take the responsibility of freeing up the memory in all the microservices. If the memory is allocated to each and every individual service separately, right? So some of the applications, they define the heap, all of them together. So one service might create a problem. Again, they refactor it, but there are some high sensitive applications. For some of the services, they give it different memory allocations. Okay.
Krishna, can we talk about non-heap area, like what is permzone and what is the difference between permzone and metaspace?
Oh, a good question actually. So
I would also like to know, like there are short-lived object and the long-lived object, right? So what is the impact of those? I mean, if it is like a more short-lived object, what is the impact of this on the application from performance?
In the concepts of garbage collection, right? Every garbage collection, if you take from the latest survey from the Oracle JDK, 70% of the objects die young. Okay. You will not have any issues with short-lived objects. They come in, they do their task, they go out. That's all they do. The problem is with the long-lived objects. The long-lived objects, what they do is, they complete their work, but they don't go out. The task of that object is completed, but the reference is not completely, it is not broken. So there are few multiple ways. For example, if someone is evaluating you in performance engineering interest, they might ask you, can I directly delete an object which is no longer in use? Can I directly do that? Can I directly terminate some object which is creating a problem from the program? You cannot do that. It's because it will have so much external dependencies. But there are, from the development side, there are some multiple ways. The ways are, there is a separate concept called how to make an object eligible for garbage collection. If you want to make an object to be garbage collected, you have to use some ways. For example, the first one is nullifying the reference variables. I'm just telling you at a very high level. Okay, nullifying the reference variables means, nullifying the reference variables means, so if student, sorry, hang on for a moment, please. I'm having some more. Okay, so sorry, student S1 equal to new student means that I'm creating a new object. This is one object. Okay, for example, if student S2 again, I'm creating what? The same new student. He's also a new student. This is an object creation. So likewise, you will create so many students with so many objects, and they do so many activities. So if I want to make this student object, student S1, this object to eligible for to be garbage collected. So what I can do is, I can do what? S1 equal to null. If I am putting the null, what will happen? If an object is no longer required, you can assign to all the reference variables in a program. When you assign a null to any of the object, the reference to all other objects will get disconnected. It means that you are breaking the reference of this object. That means you are making this object to be eligible for GC. This is called nullifying the reference variables. For example, the database connection will happen only for once. For that, you create a connection object, connection equal to something, con equal to some object you will create. If I'm creating con equal to null, that is a one-time use. I am breaking the reference of all these objects to all the other references, and I'm making this object to be eligible for GC. Okay. The but second one.
Directly do it right, as you already said.
You will not be a part of this program. This is all a development task. No performance engineer will be a part of this program. But for the interview sake, for your performance engineering evaluation sake, as many of the practices in the evaluations have changed, many of the development engineers, development directors from the product-based companies like McAfee, Visa, MasterCard, they're asking all this stuff. In all the 7 rounds, they evaluate you. How can I make an object to be eligible for GC? You should know it, but you need not be a part of it. The second one is reassigning the reference variables. The third one is you have to create objects inside a method. Okay. Creating objects inside a method, the benefit of creating an object inside a method is when S1, S2 are created. So this S1 and S2, which are created inside a method, they become local variables of that method. So whenever I call this method, these local variables, the objects S1, S2, will be automatically destroyed, will be created. And after the method completes the local variables execution, the objects gets destroyed. What I mean to say here is, in the method, if I'm creating this S1 and S2 inside a method, this an S1 and S2 becomes local variables of that method by default. The local variables of any method by default, they are eligible for garbage collection. That is why the reason they create objects inside a method. The last one is island of isolation. So you need not have all this stuff, but for your understanding, I told you. And for your question, the problem is all with the long-lived objects. Many of the objects, after completing their own task, they will not go out and they will create some kind of duplication. And this will lead to the deadlock situation or a memory leak situation, because the same object, after completing its task, the same object will be continuously allocating the memory on the heap, right? You will be identifying that object with the help of heap dump or a thread dump, and accordingly you will see which thread or which object with the instances count with high consumed memory is the error. All right. Okay.
Radhakrishna, there is a parameter in JVM like string deduplication. So how this will be used? What is the use case of this one?
That's what I'm trying to tell you. If from the JDK 11, you have 600 plus 2000 JVM arguments only for the Java garbage collection, and to play with the garbage collection and memory, heap memory, you have 600 plus arguments. Even a Java performance guru having 20 plus years of experience, he will not be able to define what exactly is what. So from performance testing point of view, we have some default JVM arguments like adaptive policy and all of the stuff. I'll be sharing it with you all.
Krishna, non-heap area, can we discuss? Yeah, the second question was non-heap area.
Yeah, non-heap area, basically permgen, right? Permgen will have all the information of the class level information. Allow me a minute. Ankush Pandey, this can allow me a minute, please. I'm sorry. Thank you. Okay, I'm sorry. Okay, if I have clearly stated for a better understanding, I have observed many of the starters, I mean the people who started with performance testing are still finding issues with the heap memory, right? So I have written this article very recently on the heap structure. So you can go here and see what is you have in the heap structure. Okay, so these are all the errors I also have given. And if you see here, so I have clearly given. So most of us really don't know what is the difference between PermGen and Metaspace. I told you, right? PermGen is there till Java JDK 7. And after from Java JDK 8, the PermGen is completely replaced by what? Metaspace, right? Yeah. So some of them call it as a special heap. Some of them directly call it as a non-heap memory. But most majority of the people call it as non-heap memory. Heap memory, they consider it as only the young generation having Eden with multiple survivor spaces S0 and S1. And older generation is called heap. So basically, the PermGen is called non-heap. Now, after getting this Metaspace replacing the PermGen, now they are calling it as a special heap space. Okay, so do not get confused. All the static variables, the constant variables, and all the method specific values of all the methods will be stored in PermGen. Okay, for example, PermGen is completely the meta level data information. There are some functionalities in your application. For if you take Amazon or Walmart or any other commonly used site like Flipkart, so you keep searching for a product continuously. So the frequently used products, if you take, okay, everyone is now ordering a mask. So that particular class information, that all the variables of that information, of that product information, for this prolonged period of time, as it is continuously globally accessed by all the users to make this functionality to work, all the respective information with respect to as I told you, the constant variables, the method specific variables, static variables, JNA variables, all these things are stored as constant in PermGen. Okay, now you may have a question that will a GC happen on this area? Yes, it will happen. There are three different types of GCs. Minor GC will happen on young generation, major GC will happen on older generation, and the full GC will happen on the complete heap, younger, older, and PermGen. Okay, so it is saying that the main advantage of Metaspace of JDK is it is automatically removing the dead classes. Okay, so once it is reaching the maximum size, it will automatically identify the dead classes which are no longer in use, and it will try to delete on its own. Okay, the main advantage of Metaspace over PermGen is PermGen has so many cases where it has got out of memory issues. Doesn't have any internal memory techniques. Like when the memory Metaspace or PermGen is full, it doesn't have the ability to delete the dead classes automatically. But whereas in the Metaspace, it has that option. When the memory is full in Metaspace, it will automatically delete all the dead classes, and the chances of getting out of memory exception is very, very less in Metaspace.
It expands at runtime also.
You can increase all these areas. I told you, right? XX meta space size and maximum meta space size. In place of meta space, you can include PermGen for JDK. XX PermGen size and XX max perm size. I think I have mentioned. I have mentioned here. Okay. So,
remember. Just the last question.
Yes, please.
Just the last question. So can my heap usage go beyond the XMX size?
It cannot. No. If once it is reaching, it is throwing out of memory, right? Simple. Logic is simple. If it is reaching the maximum value, it is not allocating anything there, because all the objects that are coming in, they are only occupying the memory from the heap, not from the physical memory or any other memory from your machine.
So whatever the memory footprint that we see in the top command, that is heap usage or the whole JVM thing?
No, it's only the heap.
Heap, right?
Only heap, because heap itself is talking about all the perm gen, young gen, metaspace, all these things are heap. Okay.
Thank you. Yeah.
Can we combine multiple GC policies?
For now, no. I think there must be an option. Till JDK, I have never come across a situation like this using multiple GC options. It is okay, fine. So yeah. That is all for today. And remember, Java garbage collection in Java.NET is very, very huge. Okay, this comes with experience. And once you started learning with all this GC, if you want to adopt the performance engineering into your performance testing practices, you have to do some hands-on work by learning some core Java, understanding the JVM architecture, so the runtime data areas, especially the memory areas, the role of heap and stack, okay, how the classes are loaded using class loader system, how the Git compiler will work, how the GC will work, all these mechanisms, and what are all the tools that you can use. You can integrate the tools with either IDE directly with the program, or you can directly integrate with the application server on which the application is deployed. Okay, so GC is huge, and if you start learning GC now, it will take a minimum of, even if you take a separate class on GC, it will take some 7 to 10 sessions with all the practicals, real-time hands-on. So whatever we have currently discussed, I have try to optimize the content I have, which will be used for many of the people who join this session from a performance testing and engineering perspective. Okay, again, the agenda is to complete the entire topic. If at all, if you feel anything is missed, or if you want to discuss any of your questions or something, we can have the same session the next week, and we'll close this garbage collection. All right. Yeah, thanks. Thanks a lot for Gagan for taking initiation and conducting this session. Hope all of you find it useful. And thanks a lot for all of your time. And it's so nice of you. Nice talking to you. If you have any questions, you can come back to me on my LinkedIn. You can access my articles on DZone as well. You can connect to me anytime. You can connect to me anytime.
Thanks, Radhakrishnan. Thanks for your time.
Yeah. Can come back to me. Okay.
Yeah.
So nice of you. Nice talking to you. Thanks all of you.
Yeah. Thanks for the question. Thanks
for the question. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much. Bye.
Yeah, nice session.
Thank you for all the information.